I am resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever.
As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awaking, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him who is my friend and not a stranger.
For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord, and if we die, we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession.
Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this service to honor, celebrate, and remember Sandra Sue Sankey. In a time such as this, it is always good to remember that all feelings are welcome. When the grief comes, it comes, and to allow indeed sacred space for those deep feelings of love and loss to come to the surface. The family wants you to know that there's a reception after the service. We'll be outside on the labyrinth. May God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose mercies cannot be numbered, accept our prayers on behalf of your servant Sandy and grant her an entrance into the land of light and joy. In the fellowship of your saints, through Jesus the Christ, who lives and loves with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Most compassionate God, whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, deal graciously with Sandy's friends and family in our grief. Surround us with your love, that we may not be overwhelmed by our loss, but have confidence in your goodness and strength to meet the days to come through Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea.
Though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult,
there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns.
The nations are in an uproar.
the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth.
He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire.
Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
For Grief by John O'Donohue. When you lose someone you love, your life becomes strange. The ground beneath you gets fragile. Your thoughts make your eyes unsure. And some dead echo drags your voice down where words have no confidence. Your heart has grown heavy with loss. And though this loss has wounded others too, no one knows what has been taken from you when the silence of absence deepens. Flickers of guilt kindle regret for all that was left unsaid or undone. There are days when you wake up happy, again inside the fullness of life, until the moment breaks and you are thrown back onto the black tide of loss. Days when you have your heart back, you are able to function well, until in the middle of work or encounter, suddenly, with no warning, you are ambushed with grief. It becomes hard to trust yourself. All you can depend on now is that sorrow will remain faithful to itself. More than you know, it knows its way and will find the right time to pull and pull the rope of grief until that coiled hill of tears has reduced to its last drop. Gradually, you will learn acquaintance with the invisible form of your departed. And when the work of grief is done, the wound of loss will heal, and you will have learned to wean your eyes from that gap in the air and be able to enter the hearth in your soul where your loved one has awaited your return all the time.
A reading from 1 Corinthians, the gift of love. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, O Christ.
Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. The Gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
First of all, I want to thank you for coming to this service where we celebrate Sandy's life. And I want to thank Grace St. Paul as a community who took us in when we had no church home and welcomed us and made us a part of that community. I want to thank Father Steve and Deacon Nancy, who earlier had ministered in many different ways to Sandy when she was ill, and especially today to Father Richard and to Deacon Lori. She was always so excited when Deacon Lori would come and bring communion. You can't imagine what made her day. I'm going to share some stories about Sandy's life, stories that you don't know. But having been married to her for over 60 years, I know, and I think it will give you a picture, a better picture of who she is. And I'm going to have it in three different sections. I'm going to tell you she was a survivor, she was a person of great faith, and she was a devoted wife, mom, and grandmother. We all have difficulties growing up. And some of those problems that we encounter shape who we are for the rest of our life. And Sandy was no exception. She told me that by the time she was 18, her family had moved over 15 times. On occasion, she would come home from school and she would be told, "We're moving next week." She had no voice in any of that. And those moves included places from the West Coast to the Midwest, whether it was Yakima or Portland or Los Angeles or Omaha or Chicago. She went along because that's what people do when they're in a family. That created a lot of instability for someone who was growing up and someone who was young. It made it very difficult for her to have a sense of belonging, a sense of being who she was. It made it very difficult, if not impossible, to make friends. Because if you made friends, you were going to move away, and they wouldn't be there, and they wouldn't be your friends any longer. Often she was the new kid in the school, but the new kid often moved away before any other new kids came into that school. In addition, I would say one thing, and I will say no more about it. She grew up in a very dysfunctional family, an abusive family. But we're here to talk about the good news of her life. Instead of becoming a victim, she became a survivor. Oh, there were residuals, you can only imagine, in many times in her life, and they would every once in a while, pop up their ugly head. But when she went away to college, she said, "I reinvented myself. I no longer had some of the restraints that were put upon me by my family." She said, "I found freedom. I found freedom to be in the drama program, to be in a play, and to work behind the scenes. I found the freedom to be on the school newspaper and receive accolades for some of the articles that I wrote." But the most positive, life-changing experience that she had was the ability to make and to keep friends when she went to college. At the age of 18, she attended Central College. She didn't get her degree there, but years later, she got a bachelor's and a master's degree at the University of North Dakota. But the life-changing event at college for her was she met a wonderful group of young women. She had never seen them before, never met them before, and they became lifelong friends with whom she visited many times, and they were friends of hers until the day of her passing. She also made some lifelong friends in some of the churches I served, friendships that lasted 40 and 50 years. In reinventing herself, she was not a victim, she was a survivor. But secondly, faith was very important to Sandy. Her faith journey was a difficult one because as an adult, as a child, her family never went to church or almost never went to church. Oh, occasionally a neighbor would invite her to Sunday school or to Bible camp, and that was the extent of it. Until one day, she said, her parents told her they were going to church on an Easter Sunday. Well, she thought that seemed very strange, but nevertheless, they went to church. They went to a church, Omaha, Central United Presbyterian Church in Omaha. They invited her family back, but she was the only one who went. She started going regularly. She sang in the choir. And before her 16th birthday, she asked to be baptized. And she was a member of that church when we were married several years later. And that was the beginning of her faith journey. A couple of stories I'll tell you about her work in the church. She liked to be behind the scenes. She didn't want to be up here. She would rather be working, doing something in a committee. When we were in Grand Forks, she was on the mission committee, and they decided that they were going to do something different the year that they celebrated the One Great Hour of Sharing, which is a wonderful ecumenical program that supports mission and people in their need throughout the world. Well, every year before, they dragged out that ugly thermometer where you had a mark on the top and this was your goal, and then the bottom, it showed how far you were, whether you had reached your goal or not. Well, in doing something different, they saw what another church had done and they copied it. They didn't have to be original. So they decided that they asked Sandy to draw a picture of a dogwood tree. And she drew that picture, and then she enlarged it through poster board, and it went from the floor to the ceiling of the church, and all there were bare branches of a tree. But every time someone or somehow another $50 was collected, a pink blossom, a pink dogwood blossom, would be put on that tree. By the end of the campaign, the entire wall was pink. The reason I tell you this story is I went through her Bible when we were getting ready to do this service. And going through her Bible, I found something. I found one of those pink blossoms. She had kept it. It was important to her. But you need to be aware that when you look through someone's Bible, you might be surprised what else you might find. In that Bible, there was a mustard seed. And you may recall that Jesus talked about the mustard seed growing into a bush or a huge tree. And it was the faith like that of a mustard seed that would allow one to move mountains. Sandy didn't move any mountains, of course not. Not in the traditional or literal sense, but in many ways, she moved her life, and that was even greater than moving a mountain. Another aspect of Sandy's faith, she always cared for the underdog. She didn't make it very visible, but she was there caring. About 20 years ago, she went with me to a meeting of the General Assembly of the denomination in Syracuse, New York. And we were having a terrible fight in the Presbyterian Church at that time. And church fights are never fun, but they happen. Anyway, in the middle of that assembly, the moderator decided he would honor a request to allow those who supported the ordination of gay and lesbian people to quietly march through the convention center for a given amount of time and to extend to the voting community their opinions on that issue. I didn't know it, but I'm sitting in my assigned seat and I see Sandy walking through the auditorium. She had a stole over her shoulders that I had never seen before. And so she said, I said to her later, I said, I saw you were marching today. And she said, yes, I was listening to this young woman's story. And as I listened to her story, she said to me, I have met all the requirements of ordination. I've done everything that's required of me, but my own church will not allow me to be ordained. And she said, I would walk today, but I don't dare to walk because of repercussions from my church and from others. And Sandy said, I'll walk with you. I'll walk for you, she said. And so the young woman placed the stole over her shoulder, and Sandy walked that day. She had a heart for the underdog. She heard her story, and she responded. Her heart for the underdog is shown in some very simple ways. Whenever we would be going somewhere, she'd want to make sure that we had a few dollar bills in the council of the car in case we saw someone who was homeless or who had a sign, hungry. She knew that that wasn't going to solve the problem. It might help for a moment or for an hour or two. But instead of, when we drove away after she had given a dollar or two, she'd say, I wonder what her story is, or I wonder why he's in the situation he is today. Yes, she wanted to know stories, and she wanted to respond to them. One other story I will tell you about her concern for the underdog is one year, Sandy and I, when we were living in Santa Barbara, volunteered to serve dinner to the homeless on a Friday night. The church did that every week. And so we had volunteered with another couple, and she came to me and she said, you know, I know you're going to make spaghetti or goulash or something, but she said, they get that every week. We need to do something special. She says, I'm going to make a cake. You'll probably all have heard of the poke cake. So she made a cake where you poke holes in it, you pour Jell-O over it after it's baked, and then you put whipped cream or some wonderful frosting on it. Nobody said a word to me about the goulash or the spaghetti. I don't even know what we served. But one young man came up and he said, I want to thank whoever made that cake. I want to thank that person because my mom used to make those cakes. She listened, she heard a story, and she responded. Now I'm going to mention a few things about our family. Her family was the most important thing to her that could ever be. I could tell you lots of stories in our 60 plus years of marriage. Of course, we had our disagreements. But as I thought about them before I got up here today, I thought, you know, I really don't remember any of those big disagreements. Instead, I remember the lighter moments. Last week, making an effort to continue our family traditions, I decided it was appropriate, as we always did, the day after Thanksgiving, to decorate the Christmas tree. And I started to do so, and I had this voice in the back of my head saying to me, you know, those two ornaments on the bottom are too close together. And then I also heard this other voice saying, well, maybe that ornament should go in the back of the tree. I'm sure I'm going to hear that voice many times in the days to come. Sandy was a mom, and she was a good mom. And like any mom, she made mistakes from time to time. But starting out as a mom with our first child, she had virtually no confidence. She wouldn't do anything without reading Dr. Spock's book on child rearing. And many times that didn't bring her the answer. But she loved her kids from the day they were born till the days after they left their nest. She loved them when they made mistakes and had to find a way to solve them. She never stopped caring. When Mark was a baby, he was born in Iowa, and it was about very hot and humid in the summer. And one day she said, I wonder if I can take him outside without a blanket. Well, she wasn't sure what to do, and I said, yeah, I don't know why you can't. It's really pretty warm outside. And she said, well, what do you know? You've only been a dad for a couple of weeks either. So, you know, so okay. So she decided that she would call our doctor. She called Dr. Canis, and he was very patient. He said to her, well, of course you can take him outside. Those were in the days when you could call a doctor and they actually called you back or spoke to you. Of course you can take him outside. And so the problem was solved. But she could be like a mama bear protecting her cubs as well. On our fifth anniversary, Lisa became very sick, running a very high fever. She ran that high fever, and we decided we needed to see the doctor, but we lived in a town of 200 people. There was no doctor, there was no hospital, no emergency room. So we drove over 20 miles to the hospital. We got to the hospital, and the doctor walked into the room, and he examined her, and he said, it has the next thing to pneumonia. Take it home and give it this medicine. And if it's better in the morning, if it's not better in the morning, bring it back. She paused for a moment, and she said, she's a she, not an it. Our youngest child came to us in a different manner. She came to us through adoption, and we had always told her that she was a part of our family, just as important as everyone else, but she came to us differently. One day when she was 4 or 5, and Sandy had studied and read everything you can imagine on adoption, when she was 4 or 5, and Marie came to her and said, Mommy, did I grow in your tummy? And she said, no, honey, you didn't grow in my tummy. You grew in my heart. The last story I'm going to tell you, excuse me. Last story I'm going to tell you is about Sandy as a grandma. During pandemic, we all went through some very difficult times. Our family was affected, our kids were affected. And so almost every night, the two kids who lived here came to our house for dinner or after dinner. And along with one of our children came a great-granddaughter. And we established a ritual. And that ritual was that after we had spent our time together, an hour or so, or two maybe as a family, it was time for them to leave. And the granddaughter would give everyone a hug. First she gave Papa a hug, then she would give Uncle Mark a hug, And then, even though Sandy had her feet elevated for various reasons, she would make a running leap onto Sandy's lap, and she would give her the biggest hug you could ever imagine. I don't know who enjoyed it more. Well, the first time she came after Sandy's passing, it was time for them to leave. And she said, or she gave me a hug. She gave Uncle Mark a hug. And she said something that we weren't prepared for. She said, "What about Grandma?" We all paused for a moment, and I said, you can give Pop a big hug, and he'll make sure that Grandma gets it. Sandy, you are truly a survivor. You are a woman of faith. You are a wonderful mom and grandmother. You are my beloved.
Thank you, Lee. Thank you for your words, honoring your beloved. You asked me, Lee, to say a few things about the texts, so I will make them few. Lee, you chose this beautiful poem by John O'Donohue to be in Sandy's service. And the poem brings home the harsh reality of loss and grief. Life becomes strange. It's not the same anymore. One's heart can be so very heavy at times. The silence of absence deepens. And one is thrown back onto the black tide of loss, as if a wave has knocked a person back. As the grief comes and comes for as long as it takes. I love this sentence, "You are ambushed with grief." And I think that is so often the experience of people who have loved deeply and then have lost. And the sharpness of the pain comes as if it's coming out of nowhere. And the reminder is once again that the person is gone and the loss is felt deeply. The price of loving deeply means that the pain will be also felt so very deeply. And the ending of the poem is very dear, that in the soul of the one who is grieving, the loved one, is there a waiting return all the time? And so in the heart, Sandy, of course, will always be with you. As those of us who have lost spouses know, the beloved is with us. You chose this marvelous passage from Isaiah, 700 years written before Jesus. And there's the great claim and the vision of the prophet that death one day, at one time, will be swallowed up forever. And then in the psalm, you chose these mighty claims of God as our refuge and strength. A very present help in times of trouble. And he too has a vision of this unknown poet, or she has this vision of the time when wars will cease, To the end of the earth, he breaks the bow that shatters the spear, burns the shields with fire. This end of militarism and violence is in God's heart and desire for his beloved, her beloved, humanity. Besides the bow and the spear and the shields being gone, so will the missiles, the drones, and the AK-47s one day, as we press on in that great, great hope. When I was looking at the gospel, the setting is, of course, the raising of Lazarus, and he is the brother of Martha, the woman who is interchanging with Jesus, and I hear her impatience and her insistence, you know, that Jesus had made a mistake. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. If Sandy had been there, it would have been much harder words. I think she really would have given it to him. And be a little, that with that fierce side of Sandy, I can see coming out there and calling Jesus to be accountable. I love that fierce side of Sandy, and the strength, bluntness, if not stubbornness, from time to time. And then Jesus ends up saying, you know, that he is the resurrection and the life. And I'm reminded of that part of John's gospel: I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. It's all about life. And the very heart of resurrection is life. And so there's the great challenge of coming to terms with a whole new way of living, and how difficult that is to find one's balance again. And none of us can do it alone. And that is where our community is so greatly needed, our family, our loved ones, so that we don't dare such an undertaking all by oneself. And then the great passage of Paul's, the gift of love, often used in weddings, sometimes treated with sentimentality, and yet a deeper reading of the passage. You know, this is not shallow stuff at all. It is sometimes framed as an invitation, this passage on love. It is an invitation to enter into the realm of love, the power of love, the value of this power that takes us out of ourselves if we go into it, practicing this outgoingness of trust. And towards the end of this passage are these words paraphrased in the message: we'll see it all then, see it as clearly as God sees us, knowing him directly, just as he knows us. And here's the place for all of us to be, to allow ourselves to be known by our Creator, to be in that place of connection and relationship, even in the midst of loss, and taking now the journey back towards the light and finding our way back, for it is there, he is there, awaiting us and being with us on the way. Amen.
In the assurance of eternal life given at baptism, let us proclaim our faith and say, I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another. Peace.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. For our sister Sandy, let us pray to our Savior Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Jesus, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Sandy, and dry the tears of those who weep.
God of love, be with us in our grief.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
God of love, be with us in our grief.
You raised the dead to life. Give to our sister Sandy eternal life.
God of love, be with us in our grief.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister Sandy to the joys of heaven.
God of love, be with us in our grief.
Our sister Sandy was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints.
God of love, be with us in our grief.
She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
God of love, be with us in our grief.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Gracious God, we commend to you our sister Sandy. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death, and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and where you live and reign with Jesus and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages.
Thank you.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant Sandy with your saints.
Where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust. Yet even at the grave we make our song, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant Sandy with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Sandy. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming, receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
Amen.
Father and Mother of all, we pray to you for those we love, but see no longer. Grant them your peace. Let light perpetual shine upon them, and in your loving wisdom and almighty power, work in them the good purpose of your perfect will, through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant to her, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon her. May her soul and the souls of the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Remembering what Sandy taught you, let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.